Hey, as in Chandler, my friends, Dr. Allen here. Today, we're going to be talking about red light therapy and dry eyes. A few months ago, I did a video on red light and all the research going into the applications of red light therapy for various eye conditions. And one of the main areas where red light therapy is currently being offered through eye clinics is specifically for dry eye treatment. So in today's video, I really wanted to break down how this works, what the research is showing, where red light therapy may be able to offer and help you in terms of your dry eye symptoms and different clinical findings, but then also review who this may work best for and the differences between the red light treatments that are offered in eye clinics versus all the various red light devices you may find online. Now, the first thing I want to mention is that most eye clinics do not refer to this as red light therapy. We usually refer to it as low-level light therapy, or LLLT. Also, in the research, if you dig into this yourself, you may find that not every research publication refers to this as red light therapy or LLLT. They may refer to it as NIR for near infrared, as well as photobiomodulation, which is sort of the overarching term to describe really how red light therapy works and helps our tissues. The fundamental idea of red light therapy is because specific wavelengths of light do penetrate deeper into our tissues with red light and near infrared light penetrating the deepest. And the reason why we can't go too much higher than that is that once you start getting above the near infrared light, up to like 1,000 nanometers of light, water in your tissues start to absorb that light, and that ends up causing heat. And too much heat results in tissue damage. So that's why, again, there's kind of a therapeutic window for light treatments. In addition to this, research has found out that specific wavelengths of light can absorb and activate certain cellular machinery within our tissues, namely mitochondria, and this can help activate our immune systems. It can help with cell proliferation and wound healing, as well as reduction in inflammation. In particular, red light of about 600 to 700 nanometers of light enhances our immune cell activation, as well as cell proliferation for things like collagen synthesis, where near infrared light of about 800 to 850 nanometers of light, that plays a larger role in its anti-inflammatory effects. Some red light devices or low-level light therapy devices do just single specific wavelengths of, let's say, 630 nanometers of light, but a lot more of the newer devices used in the research also are not just doing one specific wavelength, they're in fact doing multiple specific wavelengths. So they're giving off not just 630 nanometers of light, they're also giving off 850 nanometers of light simultaneously, really just to enhance those beneficial effects. Now, this red light or low-level light therapy is not the only treatment in the dry eye space to use photobiomodulation to really enhance the symptoms and treatment for dry eye. There is another device that's in fact been used for well over a decade in the dry eye space, and we call that intense pulsed light, or IPL. Really, what IPL is, and how it's a little different than this low-level light therapy that we're referring to, is that IPL delivers not just one specific wavelength of light, it actually gives a huge broad band of wavelengths called polychromatic light. So it's treating not just 630 nanometers of light, it's actually treating 500 to 1200 nanometers of light as one big energy pulsed dose to a very specific treatment area. And because IPL delivers some of the same wavelengths of light that are utilized in low-level light therapy, you also get some of the same photobiomodulation benefits, including that of reduction in inflammation, the reduction in reactive oxygen species, as well as improvement in cellular production of things like collagen synthesis, for example. But IPL does have a few other advantages. IPL also induces thrombosis, or photocoagulation, of basically burning off the small abnormal blood vessels that can grow deeper within our tissues around our face and our eyelids. This is great for people with rosacea or ocular rosacea of the eyelids. The IPL also produces a little bit more heat in the tissues, which can help melt any of the thickened oils that are trapped within the meibomian glands of the eyelid. And IPL has demonstrated the ability to kill off bacteria and other microorganisms that often live in our eyelashes and around our periorbital area, even including that of Demodex mites, which also have strong implication for causing and contributing to dry eye disease. However, IPL is not ideal for everyone, especially for people with darker skin complexions, as the IPL can cause damage to melanin and cause hypopigmentation for those individuals. Whereas red light or low-level light therapy has the advantage of being largely athermal and safe for all skin types, as well as being able to treat the upper eyelid and the periorbital areas where it's largely agreed upon is unsafe to treat with IPL. Now, if I haven't lost you already, you may be wondering, why in the world am I talking so much about intense pulse light or this IPL therapy? Well, the reason why is because a lot of the research studies on the application of red light or low-level light therapy for dry eyes is, in fact, looking at both of these treatments together and using low-level light therapy alongside IPL. Whereas in one study from 2021, where they utilized both low-level light therapy and IPL together, they had improvements not only in the patient's dry eye symptoms, but also improvement in tear film osmolarity or salt content. They also had improved stability in the tear film from non-invasive breakup time, as well as overall improved tear production. And then in another study from 2023 that actually looked at multiple IPL devices, one of the devices used low-level light therapy together, and they concluded that that treatment protocol, in fact, ended up with the best long-term benefits, as well as improved benefits for lacrimal production, which is, in fact, in agreement with other publications that show that this low-level light therapy can reduce inflammatory cells that are attacking the lacrimal gland and helping the gland produce more of your own natural tears. Now, I will admit, there are not a ton of research publications right now on just this red light or low-level light therapy as a dry eye treatment in isolation. But here is one from 2022. This study had 20 participants receiving low-level light therapy twice a week for 3 weeks versus a placebo group. And in the results, they showed significant improvement in both corneal and conjunctival surface staining, which means that basically the surface of the eye wasn't receiving as much damage. They also reported improved tear production as well as improved meibography scores for the upper eyelids. They also reported some improvement in tear film stability as well as meibomian gland expressibility, except it wasn't statistically significant. And then in another study I found, they actually put up low-level light therapy versus the IPL. And at the end of that study, they reported significant improvements in both dry eye symptoms as well as meibomian gland expressibility in both groups. However, the IPL group did have greater efficacy in terms of visual improvement, light sensitivity, as well as improved burning sensations, especially for people with more advanced meibomian gland dropout. Okay, now, after hearing all this, you may be thinking, Dr. Allen, this all sounds great, but am I a candidate? Is this going to work for me? Well, just looking at the data, it's clear that this is probably going to help reduce inflammation, which plays a huge role in dry eye. It's going to help with production of better meibum or oils, which is great for people with evaporation of their tears. And it's going to help with tear production. Also, maybe even a little bit of collagen synthesis, which may help with the kind of the tension of the eyelids in helping you produce more expression from meibomian glands when you're blinking. So this is probably going to be best for someone with evaporative forms of dry eye disease, which thankfully is most people who are suffering from dry eye symptoms. However, again, it's not going to be best for everybody. For example, if you are somebody who has dry eye from thyroid eye disease, probably not the best option. But really, it comes down to the fact that dry eye is really complex, and I don't think I'll be able to tell you that you'd be a good candidate just from this video. It's something you have to talk with your local eye doctor and a dry eye specialist to determine if this would be advised. But where I see low-level light therapy being more of an advantage are for people with darker skin complexions, and also just for the fact that it's usually a bit cheaper than treatments such as with the IPL, where IPL can cost somewhere between $300 to $400 for a single session, usually requiring at least 4 treatment sessions, where low-level light therapy can cost somewhere around $100 to $125 for a session. So I think just the economics of it makes it a little bit easier to access. All right, now comes the question of the in-office devices used in medical clinics for low-level light or red light therapy versus the kind of over-the-counter options that maybe you can find online. Now, for this, I have been really cautious because I've gotten a lot of questions about, hey, which devices can I just purchase online and use? Or, hey, I have this device, is it being effective? And the more I've researched this, the more I started to realize this area of like consumer online over-the-counter red light devices is a complete wild west. There seems to be very little regulation and a lot of inconsistencies amongst messaging coming from just different marketing practices. In fact, I've even seen one device that is sold for like maybe a few $100s, and then the exact same device, just a different color with a different logo on it, sold on other websites and even in person for 3 to 5 times the price. It really seems like almost anybody can start manufacturing one of these devices and make claims about it and just sell it and just, I don't know. It leaves me with a lot of hesitation about making claims about any of these over-the-counter devices. I'm very skeptical. Really, when it boils down to it, the concern between the at-home products versus what's seen in the clinic really comes down to safety and if a treatment is really going to be effective or not. It all has to really boil down to dosage, or what we refer to as fluence, which is calculated by the power density times the time of application. The advantage that the devices used in medical clinics has is that they're capable of producing a greater energy output, and with that, they can therefore decrease the time of application needed to get that appropriate dosage. So essentially much more efficient. Otherwise, a lot of the devices I've been finding that are sold online, they have a very low energy power, and so because of that, to get an effective treatment, you'd have to probably treat for multiple hours at a time, which just isn't efficient. And that's assuming that you're trusting the power density output that the marketing teams are claiming those devices are able to achieve. And then there's also the extra kind of variable involved with the distance of treatment from the device being right against the face, or is it hovering a little bit further out, a few centimeters, inches, or even maybe a few feet from the treatment zone. Now, with this being said, there is in fact publications of a device designed to be basically kind of rented out from an eye clinic that you would take home and you can treat every day just in the comfort of your own home without having to drive to the eye clinic so much. And that publication does show good results. And it also has some extra safety features on there, so somebody can't like abuse the device and use it too much. Again, I think safety is definitely an important thing we need to be cautious about. I do personally have some meetings scheduled with a few companies that have devices that can be sold online for both treatment of dry eye as well as other eye health things. But I want to meet with them first to better ask them how these devices work, questions about safety, and if it's something that I would ever personally endorse or recommend for anybody. Again, I'm very cautious about this, and at least at this time, I would still urge people that if you're thinking about getting red light or low-level light therapy, specifically for dry eyes, best to always talk with your local eye care provider, and if you're going to trust anybody, probably trust the device that they have, as that has much higher regulation around safety, and they're also trained to use those devices versus there's just a lot of question and hesitancy that I have about a lot of the things sold online. But hey, thank you so much for watching today's video. If you did find some value in it, please consider subscribing to the channel and turning on the notification bell so that you can be notified when my next videos come out, as I will be producing a video going more in depth about all the different kind of at-home devices for red light therapy. Otherwise, if you do have other questions about today's videos, I know I threw a lot of information at you, so please drop those questions in the comment section. I'll do my best to get back to you. Otherwise, again, Dr. Allen here from the Dr. Eye Health Show. Thank you so much for watching. Keep an eye on it. and we'll see you in that next video.